Good evening. Welcome to evening prayer on the Thursday before Lectionary 25, September 17th, 2020. I'm having evening prayer in my office tonight. Well, for two good reasons. One is our bells are practicing in the main sanctuary tonight. And our school, Luther Moore Academy, has a very popular and well-run, it's called Lego League, and they are practicing and doing their things in the parlor area and the room next to the chapel. So all that to say is there is some good activity and energy in the building tonight, which I do so welcome, and I thought some of that noise perhaps would overflow into the chapel for tonight. So I quickly moved up to my not-so-tidy office tonight. But I do have the cross and the candle, and most importantly, we will be sharing the Word. The bulletin is before you, very familiar to us by this point, so we find peace and assurance in knowing that we have this consistency in the midst of our chaotic life. So we will begin our evening prayer. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. We now read together. O gracious light, pure brightness of the ever-living Father in heaven, O Jesus Christ, holy and blessed, now as we come to the setting of the sun, and our eyes behold the Vesper light, we sing your praise, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You are worthy at all times to be praised by happy voices, O Son of God, O Giver of life, and to be glorified through all the worlds. Psalm 145, verses 1 through 8. I will exalt you, O God, my King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day will I bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. There is no end. One generation shall praise your works to another and shall declare your power. I will ponder the glorious splendor of your majesty and all your marvelous works. They shall speak of the might of your wondrous acts, and I will tell of your greatness. They shall publish the remembrance of your great goodness. They shall sing of your righteous deeds. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great kindness. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Our first reading tonight comes from the book of Nahum. An oracle concerning Nineveh, the book of the vision of Nahum of Elkosh. The Lord has commanded concerning you, your name shall be perpetuated no longer. From the house of your gods I will cut off the carved images and the cast image. I will make your grave, for you are worthless. Look! On the mountains, the feet of one who brings good tidings, who proclaims peace. Celebrate your festivals, O Judah. Fulfill your vows. For never again shall the wicked invade you. They are utterly cut off. A shatterer has come up against you. Guard the ramparts. Watch the road. Gird your loins. Collect all your strength. For the Lord is restoring the majesty of Jacob, as well as the majesty of Israel, though ravagers have ravaged them and ruined their branches. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We now read in unison the third song of Isaiah. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has dawned upon you. For behold, darkness covers the land, deep gloom enshrouds the peoples. But over you the Lord will rise, and his glory will appear upon you. Nations will stream to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawning. Your gates will always be open. By day or night, they will never be shut. They will call you the City of the Lord, the Zion of the Holy One of Israel. Violence will no more be heard in your land, ruin or destruction within your borders. You will call your walls salvation, and all your portals praise. The sun will no more be your light by day. By night you will not need the brightness of the moon. The Lord will be your everlasting light, and your God will be your glory. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Our second lesson comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 13. This is the third time I am coming to you. Any charge must be sustained by the evidence of two or three witnesses. I warned those who sinned previously and all the others, and I warn them now while absent, as I did when present on my second visit, that if I come again I will not be lenient, since you desire proof that Christ is speaking in me. He is not weak in dealing with you, but is powerful in you, for he was crucified in weakness, but lives by the power of God. For we are weak in him, but in dealing with you we will live with him by the power of God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So most of you would know that our Sunday readings come from what is called the Common Lectionary. And the Common Lectionary lists all the Sunday readings which are read over a three-year period. The Common Lectionary are readings that are selected that are meant to represent all of the stories and themes as found within the Bible. In preparing for this evening, I learned something that I never knew before, which I am kind of embarrassed in not knowing, and that is that the book of Nahum, which is our first reading for tonight, is not part of our common lectionary, which means that the prophet Nahum will not be read on Sunday mornings in church. I'm going out on a limb by guessing here tonight that most of you know very little about Nahum. But not just you, because what I once knew about Nahum, I know no longer. So tonight I thought I would take this opportunity for all of us to be super smart about the Bible and learn something about this little known prophet. But before I get into the few facts that I was going to share about Nahum, I wanted to say a little something about what is a prophet and what is not a prophet, and what it actually means in being called a prophet. I have been here at this church long enough now to find myself repeating myself not just once or twice, but many times. And one of the things that I have shared, I know, in many different moments when speaking about who a prophet is this phrase that I picked up from my Hebrew professor, Brooke Schramm, and that is, a good prophet is a dead prophet. What this means is that prophets are people who say things that people do not want to hear. A prophet speaks very harsh and uncomfortable words, and in my experience, there are not many people who like to hear things that are harsh and uncomfortable, especially when they are true and they are sent and focused on the people that are listening. We have all heard the phrase, when bringing bad news, don't shoot the messenger. Well, this is kind of like that, in that when the prophet tells you that what you're doing is wrong and unjust and dishonest and unfair, rather than admitting that the prophet is right and we change our ways, we just end up killing that person and who tells us that we are doing wrong, which means that good prophets are dead prophets. Good prophets do not tell you what it is that you wish it is that you would hear. But good prophets tell you what it is that God wishes you to know. Another part of being a good prophet is that you lead a very lonely and a very difficult life. There have not been many prophets in the world. It's really a pretty small bunch, and I would not wish that hard life on anyone. Jeremiah, for instance, describes the life of being a prophet of God as being overpowered and overwhelmed by God, so much so, if you would excuse this very harsh metaphor this evening, that one is actually being raped by God. I know that is a very hard thing for all of us to hear tonight, but God so overwhelms that person, that prophet, that the prophet has no choice in order to speak those very truthful words to people who wish not hear them, which is why the prophet leads such a harsh and difficult and lonely life. The prophet is a person, a real person, not simply this microphone. And the prophet is endowed with a mission, with the power of the word that is not of her own accounts or greatness, but words with temperament and concern and character and also individuality. Such an individual who says no to her society, condemning its assumptions and habits, its complacency, and its waywardness. She was often compelled to proclaim the very opposite of what was expected of her. Her fundamental objective was to reconcile humanity with God. Nahum, in our reading tonight, sounds very much like a biblical prophet, in that he says at the very beginning, "The Lord has commanded concerning you, your name shall be perpetuated no longer. From the house of your gods I will cut off the carved image and the cast image. I will make your grave, for you are worthless." Nahum appeared in and around 612 BCE to a troubled Jewish community under a great amount of stress, and his sayings encouraged the people to celebrate the destruction of Nineveh, that great capital city of Assyria, in which that we heard and will be hearing about this week with Jonah. As according to Nahum, the fall of the city was God's judgment against the oppressive Assyrian superpower. So along with speaking these very hard words of truth, prophets also, though, just as importantly, provide words of hope. For after the proclamation of both judgment and exile, which are part of what Nahum prophesies, there is the promise of restoration and peace. Even after all of the harsh and honest language, there is always hope offered through the call of repentance, by changing one's ways and turning back to the Lord. And although Nahum spoke God's words to God's people 2,632 years ago, his words still speak to us today, along with Jeremiah and Isaiah and Ezekiel and Jonah and John the Baptist and Jesus, who was crucified, died, and was buried. The prophets remind us of the moral state of a people, that to a person endowed with prophetic sight, everyone else appears blind. And to a person whose ear perceives God's voice, everyone else seems like they are deaf. No one is just. No knowing is strong enough to trust complete enough. But the prophet, like Nahum this evening, must live on the summit to avoid the abyss. There is nothing to hold on to except for God. Amen. We now join in our song of praise by sharing the Song of Mary. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on his lowly servant. From this day all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arm. He has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones and has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care, and guide us in the way of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us by your Holy Spirit. Grant, Lord, not to be anxious. Grant us, Lord, not to be anxious about earthly things, but to love things heavenly. And even now, while we are placed among things that are passing away, to hold fast to those that shall endure. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord Jesus, stay with us, for evening is at hand and the day is past. Be our companion in the way, kindle our hearts and awaken hope, that we may know you as you are revealed in Scripture and the breaking of bread. Grant this for the sake of your love. Amen. I will now offer some of the prayer and petitions that have been given to us to this community of faith. And then after those names have been shared and offered, to share those names that are in your heart. We pray for Kathy and Bob, for Dave, Judy and Robert, Juliet, Karen, Laura Beth, Dorothy, Suzanne, Shirley, Jack, Mike, Sutton, David, Cheryl, Patricia, Jessica, Linda, Bill, Grace. We pray for Larry, for Patrice, John and Naomi, Madison and family, Linda, Carol and Frank, for Katrina, Amanda and Joe, Mitch, Dr. Bill, Valerie, Chet and Pam, baby Mike, Blair and Heather, Lucas, Brandon, Brent and Kevin, Pastor Zacherson and family, Brandon and Stacy, Jennifer, Linda, Michael, and Andrew. We now offer the names that are upon our hearts. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, our preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies, that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Glory to God, whose power, working in us, can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to Him from generation to generation in the Church, and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you for joining us this night for evening prayer. I hope this sets up for a restful night, and also to be grateful as we awake tomorrow to a new day. So I do appreciate your faithfulness in participating, and I will see you again very shortly. Bye-bye.